Again, very good afternoon to everyone here. And after listening to all the discussion regarding Torix multifocals and how to upgrade your premium practice, there is often at least once in a day a patient will come in your clinic and will challenge you when it comes to diagnosis, decision making, surgical skill. It will challenge you in every way. And this is some of the few examples that I'm going to run through today. First case is a 76-year-old gentleman, comes for a cataract surgery, retired, has an easy lifestyle, doesn't drive, doesn't do much, and has a standard grade 3, grade 4 cataract appropriate to his age. And this is what I would do. I would put the patient on slit lamp and I would be doing this some time back. I'd look straight for the cataract and see what the cataract is. But if I would just put a diffuser on, I can see that the patient has a long-standing pterygium. The pterygium is atrophied and is lying in a corner. The patient is okay with it because he's been living with it. There is no cosmetic issue and it looks like the pterygium has already died a natural death. If you look at the keratometry readings, there's a mild astigmatism. And so we wouldn't be worried about this pterygium in any way. But if you look at a topography of the patient, if you look at the topographical map, one would realize that the astigmatism that the patient has, although minimal, is irregular. The cornea is not good and the patient has an optical problem because of the pterygium, which is going to stay, which is not going to go. Again, aberrometry, as Dr. Shail brought up very nicely, will tell you how a corneal aberration profile in this patient, if you look, the cornea has significant all red aberrations, which means the cornea is not good, and so the visual quality of the patient is not good. It has been known in literature many times, the pterygium, sometimes also related to the size of the pterygium and its activity, can cause higher order aberrations, particularly coma aberrations, because it pulls the cornea on one side, so one cornea gets flat, the other half doesn't get flat, and so the aberrations are irregular. So I would say in such a patient where the cornea is not good, predictability of IOL power calculation is always a problem, because what K reading you take and which K reading holds valid is a problem. These patients will always complain of ocular surface disturbances and visual quality disturbances, no matter how good a technical outcome is surgically. And so in this patient, because the pterygium is atrophic, I would choose to leave the pterygium as it is, but I would counsel the patient and would not even... Obviously, the premium IOLs like multifocal or toric will not do as good, but I would go so far ahead as to not even implant an aspheric lens in the eye. Because if the cornea is bad, the light will only reach the lens after it crosses the cornea, and the light is already aberrated at that time. And the aspheric lens will even accentuate a problem which is already there at the cornea. But what of other patients who come with coexisting cataract and astigmatism? Again, as I said, pterygium induces higher order aberrations, and topography shows that removing an active pterygium can drop or change the aberration profile of the patient's eye. This is another patient with an active pterygium, thick fleshy pterygium. So in this patient, with the understanding and the knowledge that the pterygium excision will cause change in aberrometry profile, we went ahead, Dr. Vandana Nath in our hospital does this surgery of pterygium excision, and we did a conjunctival autograft. And I want you to notice, again, as I showed over here, the corneal irregularity is showing a higher corneal aberration before a pterygium extraction, and this is after pterygium. So all the coma aberration that was happening because of the corneal pull has now shifted to an astigmatic profile because the cornea has bounced back after the pterygium has been removed. And this shows pictographically so beautifully that what's happened. So in this patient, now that we know that the cornea is now regular and the patient has a regular astigmatism, we counsel the patient for a toric IOL, but we also counsel the patient for surface symptoms because we did touch up the surface and the surface will take time to heal. The patient put on postoperative extensive lubrication and the patient is happy with an unaided vision of 6-9. So like in all patients, we have to evaluate and understand, particularly in such situations, whether you want to put a toric lens or not, depending on the corneal astigmatism. Another case, again, to discuss a toric IOL of a patient, 56-year-old person, who comes up and we check his refraction as a 6-cylinder, a significant cylinder. And this would ring a bell in any clinician's mind that the patient has a keratoconus or a peripheral corneal degeneration. And this is a classical crab claw pattern. In this patient, the general dictum would be to avoid advanced technology IOLs and toric IOLs because they will induce higher order aberrations rather than not. But often what we often miss looking in our clinic is that most of these machines give us the pupillary size. And most of the investigations should be done in dim lighting conditions to understand how much the patient dilates in dim light. If you look at this patient, the pupil is just this much in dilated condition. And within this zone, the patient is a regular astigmatism. So this picture would confuse you and tell you that the patient has a crab claw, bad cornea. But if you look at the patient's physiology, this is where the patient is seeing from. So if you notice again over here, the predominant aberration that comes out in the cornea is astigmatism. We counsel this patient, understanding the optics of the eye, for a maximum power available for a cylindrical lens, with the understanding that we would leave behind certain astigmatism which would not be correctable by the choice of our IOL. So 1 month post-op, patient best corrected is 6.9, and the only refraction the patient needs is that cylinder that we left behind because we could not treat it at the IOL plane. And the patient, but more importantly, the patient says that the patient has never seen this good in his eye and in his entire life. And it is because of the optics that we understood. So this is the patient pre-op, and this is the patient post-op. So if you notice over here, although part of the cornea is compensated by the lens and part is not, the visual quality of the patient is significantly better. So again, toric IOL can be implanted in corneas, particularly keratoconics and peripheral pellucid degenerations, but understand that the central cornea should be regular and should be a regular astigmatism. Trauma is another situation that comes to our clinic, to anybody's clinic. And this is a 28-year-old gentleman who comes up with a history with a glass. This is what the patient looks like. The patient has a self-sealed corneal wound, and there is an anterior capsule split, and the whole lens matter is hydrated. So in this patient, first, it is important to look at the patient in all possible directions using a slit lamp or an operating microscope to understand the anatomy of the eye and what has gone wrong. We made two side port entries into the eye. Because this patient has no nucleus sclerosis, we never made a main incision because we wanted to maintain the closed chamber technique. And we used very, very low parameters to gently remove all the fluffy cortical matter, the hydrated lens material of the patient. And because we did not know what the posterior capsule status of the patient is, we wanted to use very low vacuum. We're playing around 100 vacuum, very low flow rate, and an IOP of just 50 on this Centurion platform, which gives us excellent control. So by shifting hands and by changing hands, we were able to manage and clear up the complete capsular bag. Fortunately for us, we realized that there is no posterior capsule defect whatsoever. And at this point in time, this is when I say we have decision making on table sometimes happens, is where what would you want to do with this patient and what lens would you want to implant and where? Putting a single piece lens inside the capsular bag may not give it support because the anterior capsule is split. For that matter, any lens that you put inside the capsular bag may not stay there because the capsule may run away or the lens may tilt. So we decided primarily to do a primary posterior capsular excess. Now if you notice over here, we are using these 23 gauge microcapsular excess forceps to fashion a posterior capsular excess. The patient had an intact posterior capsule, just to recollect, but we used the bimanual technique and as many times as required to change of hands as to complete a posterior capsular excess. In this patient, we wanted a stable IOL that stays because it's a young patient and we don't want any post-op complications. So we also had to enlarge the anterior capsular excess so we can accommodate an IOL and implant an IOL in the capsular bag. And so we enlarged the split into as much of a excess pattern as we could. And our choice of lens for this patient was a three-piece lens. The idea was to put the lens in the capsular bag, and we used the holder-folder technique and not the cartridge because we find more control with the holder-folder technique. So we opened the lens in the capsular bag with the leading haptic, and the trailing haptic was gently dialed into the capsular bag, as you can see over here. But the idea for stability was to tuck the optics of the three-piece behind the posterior capsular excess, or what we would call an optic capture. Right now, because this would be the only way we could hold or ensure that the lens is going to be stable, centered on the patient's visual axis and will never move. We did that and we checked for any vitreous disturbance, if it was any, because we had caused so much manipulation using triamcinolone alone. But fortunately, luckily for us, there was absolutely no vitreous disturbance and we were able to close the surgery. And this is how the patient looks on the first week follow-up. It's a well-centered IOL. It's not going to move anywhere because now it is captured behind the optics are captured behind the posterior capsule and the haptics are lying in the capsular bag. So the lens is locked into its place and it's unlikely to go anywhere. But I'd like to end with this case over here of some things that sometimes we induce with the normal routine cataract surgery, normal phaco. This is a lady who's, we've already done one eye and she's extremely happy, confident with the surgeon. And we are doing the left eye surgery. Standard straightforward gate to cataract. If you notice over here, there is some sort of occlusion that's happening at the phaco tip. And there was a sudden post-occlusion surge. It took a little while for us to understand when we removed the remaining nuclear material that we have actually induced the PCR because of that surge that happened. Because we forgot to pay attention and we put the foot pedal down, we surged and that's when the problem happened. The other mistake that happened was at the moment I recognized it, I pulled out my phaco probe out of the eye. And this is something none of us should do. I will not emphasize upon this, but it's important to maintain closed chambers so as to prevent the PCR from enlarging. But then sense prevailed and we used very, very low parameters to gently take out all the cortical material as much as we could. And whenever we changed hand, we used Viscot to maintain the anterior chamber. And this was time to assess what we did. And that is where the PCR is. It's a small limited PCR, but it has ragged edges. We wanted to understand even before we do anything to make sure that there's no vitreous. And by using triamcinolone, we realized that we did cause vitreous disturbance in the patient. Our choice of vitrectomy for any PCR now has shifted from limbal to exclusive pars plana vitrectomy. So for any patient that we, in a situation we arise and we have a PCR, we try to make a 23 gauge trocar entry in the pars plana and we approach the vitreous from behind, that is behind the posterior capsule, in order to suck the vitreous back into the vitreous cavity. Any maneuver done from the limbal route may pull the vitreous anteriorly because vitreous has a body and it has tractional bands, and this has become our choice. So after addressing vitreous, now was the choice to decide what to do, because if you remember, I told you we had to put a Restore multifocal lens in this patient's eye. We could go ahead and implant a lens in this because we had minimally enlarged the PCR or not enlarged the PCR, but the PCR had ragged edges, and once the lens goes inside the eye and all the viscoelastic will put pressure on the posterior capsule, it might split or it might run away. At this point, again, technical skill prevailing, it was a good idea for us to convert a small PCR into a rounded margin, or what we would call an eccentric posterior capsular axis, because anything that is rounded or all margins that are rounded will not run away and will give us a better stability in, when we implant an IOL. And I know it's difficult to make out over here because of the image, but this is where the PCR was converted into a PCC. See? And then using a manual injector and very, very controlled delivery of we implanted the lens in the capsular bag. Again, it's a beautiful property of the Acrosoft lens that it unfolds slowly, so you can gently maneuver it inside the capsular bag and gives you enough time to breathe when you do this so that there is no rush at all whatsoever. And notice over there, that's when the lens goes into the bag, right where we wanted it. This is how the patient looks on the first post-op day, and this is where the PCR is, but the lens is well centered, and we were able to implant a multifocal lens in the patient's eye, which otherwise would have been a very, very compromised situation had we not tackled in the right way. So I'd like to end my talk with this, but it's important to sometimes make decisions on table, because there are situations that arise that we don't have control of. But at that point in time, we have a choice, and if we are able to salvage the eye, we can put the right lens in the right place. Thank you.